Doggy dog cry. Now, first things first, I need to kick this off. I got some.
Played ska music, so it was really like an outlaw type of music, you know.
In 1960, Prince Buster started his own sound system. To steal a march on his rivals, he approached the ultimate outcasts of Jamaican society, the Rastafarians, who since the 30s had looked to Africa rather than Europe as a model. He persuaded Count Ozzy and his master drummers down from the Warwicker Hills into a recording studio.
In those days, if you say it's a Rasta, all the avenues blocked for you now. And when I make Carolina, that the Rasta, whole Rasta speak, because now, them, it was not the music world, them going to play upon sound system. And if you play upon sound system on the island, everybody go hear you.
In the early years in Jamaica, the Rastafarian community went under so much pressure, you know. At one stage, I think there was a decree in Jamaica.
To kill
the Rasta man and question him after, you know.
Count Ozzy.
You know, 90% of all the grassroots music was really played or created by the Rasta people, you know.
Rasta and Jamaican music have been inseparable ever since. Even at the independence celebrations, Count Ozzy and his troupe were part of the pageant laid on for Princess Margaret, whose reaction remains unrecorded.
We brought with us most of the music of Africa, the rhythm, the kumina, as a form of dancing, the nyabingi drumming by our Rastafarians. To that has been fused some of the jazz influences emanating from our sisters and brothers in New Orleans. Culture has been a very strong element in all our art forms, but particularly in our forms of musical expression.
I'm king from the beginning. I was made king. Lion said, I am king and I reign.
What it developed from was calypso.
Lion said, I am king and I reign.
Well, calypso singers sing about, they sang about, well, lots of them used to sing about sex. But they also sing about topical things like that, so it's coming out of that. When you want to know what's going on, I mean, you know, you listen to the songs. It is a kind of folk music.
Our country contested at the Lyceum the title Miss World. They numbered 40.
I'm calling you myself.
The emerging nation was full of optimism, and with prosperity increasing, everybody wanted to own the ska records that up until now they only had heard on the sound systems.
People started buying Jamaican records. Jamaican records was accepted as the record to buy, because you're hearing yourself, you're hearing things to do with you.
Eager to capitalize on this new market, the sound system operators reinvented themselves as record companies. Prince Buster's Voice of the People, Duke Reed's Treasure Isle, and initially the top label Coxon, run by the taciturn Clement Dodd. He was the first to realize that you could make a living beyond the sound system. With his profits, he set up the legendary Studio One, the first recording studio in Jamaica to be owned by a black man.
Studio One was a permanent place that people recorded almost every day. We were always free to go there and record whenever we feel like. And these are the kind of facilities that you got that made it a special place, you know? Because it's just like home, musically.
like Jamaica's Motown. That's where all the great artists, you know, we say they graduate at this place, Studio One. This was like a 9-to-5 job. We went there early morning and we would record all day.
When I went in there at 7, I used to live at Mr. Dad's also, this studio.
Yeah.
So every morning, I'd go to the studio with him and open the studio. He would pick up an assistant, his name is Bim Bim.
Yeah, Bim Bim.
Pick up Bim Bim first.
Yeah.
We'll go to the studio, we'll open the studio, make his rounds. Already we'll close the studio every night, drop Bim Bim home. It's like heaven.
Just like in the old days of the sound system, Coxon constantly needed new sounds to stay ahead. Every Sunday morning, young hopefuls gathered in his yard, hawking their songs and looking for a shot at the big time.
The longest live will see
them all. Listen to all them guys go up and sing. You know, and every time, but you know, we would sing around the side, you know, and they would say, "You're so good, you know." And every time them say, "You're a turn man." I said, "No, make them go on.
I saw Coxon himself did an audition, right? Or some auditions too, before I started that. And he would tell artists that he figured weren't ready. I didn't want them back. He said, okay, come back 7 years' time, you know?
It was 6 o'clock in the evening. I was the last person to go up. You know, the place was still packed. And, you know, my first song, "You Got to Be Sure of a Woman's Love." And everybody crowd around, man. Everybody say, "You the vice, yeah. You the vice." Everyone crowd around, you know, and Mr. Dad say, "Nice." And the Tuesday, I went into my first 2 songs.
Another group of youngsters signed by Coxon were the Wailers, Bunny Wailer, Bob Marley, and Peter Tosh. In 1964, within a year of Studio One's opening, they sold an astonishing 70,000 copies of Simmer Down.
Trenchtown was vibrant with a lot of activities. Place was like a, what do you call it, like a Piccadilly, like Hollywood. Music as being the center of attraction.
Everybody was singing like a family. So if the Soulettes have a recording, you'd have Bob, Peter Bunny, Delroy, you know, guys from the Paragons, everybody would come to give background support. If the Wailers have a session sometime, you would have the Ask Us Girls, "Come work with us tonight. We have 2 children listening, looking at all the harmony." So that was like fun. We weren't being paid. Because Coxon, we didn't get money that time. Sometimes we get money to buy us a patty or cocoa bread, and if we go on Fridays, we would get a pound or 30 shilling or something like that. But we didn't have a problem.
It was a very productive period in Jamaica's musical history. Hit after hit, you know, every month there would be a new hit. For different singers, and it was as if all the singers and the talent in popular music had been kept locked up in a cupboard. But from the first hit was made, it is as if the cupboard doors opened and all this talent just poured out.
Studio One's music was made downtown for downtown people. The musicianship necessary wasn't that easy to achieve if you were poor in Kingston. But luckily, there was also a downtown academy. If Studio One was Motown, the Alpha Boys School was the Juilliard School of Music.
from boys' school is a school that caters to the unfortunate. It teaches them trades that they can earn a living after they leave here, and some go abroad. I think you met Rico Rodriguez. He's a trombonist.
My mother couldn't anger me no more, and that's the way I end up in Alpha. Maybe she feel I'm more protected up there. The young man, him grow very quick, him, you know what I mean? Him become very wise very quickly. You understand? Yeah. A life, tough life, you know. Life hard. Okay. And out of poverty bring it wisdom, you understand?
Why I'm here was because my parents abandoned me, but I thank God for that in some reason. As they said, must honor thy mother and father, but I still love her, and in the future I'd like to find her. So at Alpha is good. I learn music and I also learn education.
Many of Jamaica's greatest musicians have been from Alpha. Coxon in particular was quick to appreciate the value of the kind of discipline and ability you might expect from that institution. The backbone of his house band were largely Alpha old boys, and they became the first superstars of ska, the Scatterlights.
Oh yes, the Scatterlights. That was Johnny Moore. He is touring France now. And Lester Sterling, he's in America. Tommy McCook was very good at that. He was a saxophonist. You had Don Drummond. He was very quiet. He loved his instrument. And when he was still in school, he was about the best trombonist in Jamaica.
Scatterlights were a great set of people. At the time, they were the masters. They were learned musicians. They were not just people who played music by, you know, by the breath. They were doing it by the paper. And we, the Wailers, were really enthused to have been working with the Scatterlights.
There came on the scene this talented aggregation, the most formidable array of talent which Jamaica has ever seen in a single band, and dare I say, is ever likely to see in the future. They were it. Anywhere they played, for dances, the place would be Ram Jam.
We play at a place one night and say the place loaded with people, and a woman come and dance the ska. And I'm watching that woman dance, and I see she kick back. And when we finish playing, go out, I hear the woman die, they take her out. Scarcely till she dropped them and dead. Serious thing, man.
But it's a ska killer.
Yeah, man. Yeah, man. Scatterlight carry a heartbeat. Yeah. Yeah, man.
The 2 years after independence, with the Scatterlights at their peak, was the golden age of Jamaican ska. But the foundations of the band were shaky. They became frustrated with the insularity of the Jamaican music scene. And more significantly, Don Drummond, the band's greatest genius, was slowly losing his mind. Drummond's virtuoso trombone playing lay at the heart of the Scatterlights' greatest moments.
A
A lot of his compositions were minor chord tunes, smooth, more melodic kind of flow, while Rico would be more brassy and more like orchestrated, like, you know, to the beat. Don slides with it.
Drummond took Scale to new heights of virtuosity. He had a unique style with a disturbing emotional undertow that reeked of Africa and mirrored the demons in his head.
He got in friendship with this lady, and he didn't like her dancing, and so that brought a sort of a bone of contention between them.
Jealousy and the lack of material and career advancement built up disastrously in the mind of the introspective Drummond. And on New Year's Eve 1964, he killed his girlfriend Margarita.
I used to say to myself, I wonder if he's really guilty of doing that act. But they found him guilty, and then they placed him in the madhouse, Bellevue that is. And after a while, he had some altercation with somebody there, or with people there, and or some fuss, and he died. I was sorry to hear, because he was such a great musician, very, very great, regardless of how mad he was.
Without Don Drummond, the Scatterlights were never quite the same again. And anyway, musicians couldn't make that much money in Jamaica. To make a living, many of the most talented musicians joined the thousands of other Jamaicans on the boat to England.
You know, so I'm not changed from Jamaica far. I play music long time, and I really play with no band or nothing, you know. So coming to England, try out my luck.
To the newly arrived Jamaican, London nightlife was a strange and often unnerving experience.
When you go there, you know what they was playing. Buttons up and the choo-choo-choo and all these kind of things. Knees up. Are you coming from Jamaica where you used to? So we couldn't take it. And the jazz club, well, it's never on. Every club you go in London is, sorry, you got to be a member. Won't let you. Once you're black, you can't get in. You know what I mean? You couldn't get into Ronnie Scott. You couldn't get into Lion's Corner House, the big jazz club. So then I said to Vinny, look, you build a song. We will support you and get the record like Jamaica from America. And this is how it starts.
My parents were only here 5 or 6, 7 years, until 1965. Mm. So it was almost like a letter from home, hearing rhythms, rhythm tracks from Jamaica. Shebeens and blues dances weren't just exclusively for people.
It started off exclusive.
You worked. You worked on the buses, right? Mm-hmm. And you were the conductor, and the driver's white. And then you know you can't help but being together all day long, right? And you talk about what you do for recreation, and, this is, and then you say to the driver, look, we're having a party over so and so and so and so. And he comes around and thinks, oh, that's nice, isn't it? And he tells another few of his mates of it. Yeah.
Little Miss Muffet, she sat on a tuffet. Came a big spider, sat down beside her. He frightened Miss Muffet away. Watch out! Whoa! 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 Play come off now.
We used to go down to number 9 Millennium Crescent, where was a little cafe, with a little jukebox, and you'd get some food. And I always remember Carolina was on the jukebox. And in back there was a kitchen with a chef, and you can get meat and rice. That must have been 1961.
Up on the hill, fixed him a pail of water. Jackie fell down on the bust him home.
Sister Ignatius from Alpha gave me the money to come to England. I was like our number one boy, like best boy then, you know what I mean? And she used to look after me in school very good.
He took the trumpet and he was very helpful, because I used to send him to my brother's store and so on. He used to do shopping for me.
There's this great cultural mix. And at the same time, Buster came over from Jamaica and we had access to West Indian records.
Greatly opened areas, because the British market, I mean, British record releases was pretty limited at that time. You know, we were hearing cover versions. You had to hear the original.
Yeah, we had access to the real thing. You felt like you were at the start of something there.
By 1962, the scene was big enough to move from West London to the West End. Soon, Count Suckle's The Roaring Twenties in Carnaby Street became one of the hippest venues in town.
It was a late night dive. Maltese, prostitutes, striptease girls, the old of the West End. Everybody, white, musician, because they come down, the Rolling Stones, there was scruffy, all of their stones. Because they used to play round the corner at a club called The Scene in Windmill Street, downstairs. A girl named Sandra used to run it. People was like coming at 5 in the morning, 6. And that's when I met Christine Keeler, Mandy Wright Davis, and Perfumer. I mean, I didn't know he was a minister at the time, but he just come down with the girls. Well, we used to say he was a sugar daddy.
I recall the Roaring Twenties, sometimes it's 20 of us, you know, 20, 15, you know. And going home was a problem too far. We couldn't get no taxi to go home, sometimes we have to walk, you know. Sometimes along the way you get thirsty, you know. So you drink all the milk and the orange juice inside, you know. So you have a lot of fun, you know. And you're so tired coming from the dance, you know, it's slow, you know. So it was an experience in the 60s, and I just come here,
you know. You know, I wonder when I come the first time in England, I remember. First time I leave Jamaica, right? When I come up in London, I look through the plane. And I wonder if people live here. In your storybooks, I read so much about three little pigs and the wolf. And you see, the trouble is they draw the house in the book. Then when I come in, you know, all the house stuff look like pure that house. We high in the year, and you look down. It's pure that kind of house. I say, oh yeah. And I look for the wolf over guy.
And wash all my troubles away. Like the lucky old sun, give me no.
Ska in Britain was distributed on the Bluebeat label, which was how it became known. Bluebeat was the music of choice for the mods, the scooter-riding youths who flocked to the concerts and made Britain a hugely important market for the music.
They saw me as a rebel and identified themselves as such. So there was some compatibility there. I think so, because you should see them when I make me sure. It's just come like me and them as one. And then protect her right through the tour.
Like the lucky old sun, give me nothing to do.
By 1964, Jamaican record entrepreneur Chris Blackwell was convinced he could get a UK hit with a ska record. He had the right singer in Millie Small, so he brought over Ernest Ranglin to London to provide the spark.
my house, it was more on the blues spot. You was listening to a couple of blue beat tunes and stuff like that, you know. And then the biggest breakthrough was when, you know, Millie Smalls came out with My Boy Lollipop, and I think that changed everybody.
Started to get hits in England because that's where it became an international music, especially with My Boy Lollipop by Millie Small. That put us on the map. So the uptown people started to take note to make it a national sound rather than downtown sound.
Yes, this is ska, original and indigenous. These instruments are playing a monotonic grassroots rhythm.
As uptown Jamaica and the rest of the world joyously accepted ska, downtown the music and the mood were changing.
The ska was upbeat. It expressed how the spirit of the people was. And then after, people start to observe and say, oh, this independence, I'm not really independent. What's going on? The music slowed down. Let's rock it steady and see what's going on. Slow down. Poverty breeds crime. You wake up in the morning and you don't know where next meal is coming from. You know, all kind of things start going through your mind.
For if he's rough, he's against the world. He's against the world.
By 1966, downtown Kingston was a lawless place. This was the era of the so-called Rude Boys, the ruthless gangsters who terrorized the nation.
And the Rude Boys are coming a dance, man. No care you dress in a three-piece suit. Them guys that change things, them just coming in shorts and no shirt and hard turn up back way. And the girls flap them and them just do so. That's how Rap said the name did come in, you know. And the DJ have to play when he reach, he say, cry tough with Alton Ellis. Anything you can do, I can do it better. I am the toughest, and I'm sure box of beer in the air and it mash.
This guy come to me and said, his name Busby, he was a rude boy. When I say rude, I mean rude, because he would travel with gun and he'd travel with knife, and he would take any buckle and cut you, anything. Come to me one day and say, boy, I hear everybody has seen rude boy cry tough and 07 and them guys, I want you to make one of me. You just want to boost me, and I want it by Friday. And so I said, okay, I'll make you a song, sir.
Strong like lion, we are iron, rude is no fear.
Busby listen, and say, play it back. And so when we reach strong like lion, we are iron, just take out two of the beer and throw it against the wall and crash it and say, I am. Everybody getting panic now, you know, because they're afraid of him, because they know him, what he can do from what he won't do. The whole night is the one song, it's coming like the dance stop.
Rude is on fear.
I don't know if he didn't like the song, what he would do. But anyhow, he did love it.
Boys, rude is on fear. Rougher than rough. Tougher than tough.
But he didn't love it for long. He didn't love the song for long because he loses life the following day. And we just cut out the Rude Boy songs them and said, well, if we're going to cause eruption, just leave it there.
All I need from you is a good conversation.
As things hotted up downtown, people sang, and most of them escaped into old-fashioned boy meets girl love songs. This was Rocksteady, Jamaica's first pop music, the era of singers who replaced the largely instrumental ska, and for many it was the most glorious phase in Jamaican music.
Never felt this way before, I know there is some way today.
It all came from the American R&B music, you know, because we're always being influenced by the Impressions, all them soul R&B groups.
Love your sister.
We would listen to a Dionne Warwick song and try to sing it exactly as Dionne did it. If you are a group, you would try to study the Supremes, Martha Reeves and the Vandellas. If there was a group who comes from abroad to our shores, we would want to go and see them because they have something to teach us.
It's a cultural thing for Jamaicans to sing. In the ghetto, you'll find more singers than anywhere else too, because, you know, it's a thing that, you know, it's a thing we used to pass the time away. It's a thing you used to soothe your spirit, your soul, you know.
Can't compare with, I've been touched by an angel. This heaven and earth could be no hell. I've been touched by an angel. She's on a progressive chart and will serve you where she wants. With enough confidence and never yet says she can't. And the love you know she have heal any broken heart from she coming on my life. I'm gonna stop advance, rearrange my lonely life and turn it right from start. Now I'm happy with this woman and we will never part. I know she clever and she smart. I've been touched by an angel.
Most of us, we only wanted to hear our voices on the record. To see people, to hear it on the radio, is a dream come true. To see people dancing and singing to your record for the first time is another matter completely. La, 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 la.
There was no thought of any money or anything else more than honesty, sincerity, and purity. And that is what I think that music is full of. That, you know, that is why it's lasting so long.
Songs lived. You'll have a song man 1 year straight, send it for 1 year, not a little thing like some tune come on yourself for 1 month and done. Them tune they sell and never ever die. People still buying them. My biggest sales in this tour is all this. And I have everything up to date, you know, I'm up to date.
Rocksteady saw a power shift in the music industry. It was still dominated by the former Sound System bosses, but Coxon and Studio One would never be quite the same force again. Many of the artists, like the Paragons, Alton Ellis, and the Melodians, promptly signed up with his old rival Duke Reed, who still ran his own Sound System and realized the potential of the more easily danceable rock steady beat.
When the first song came out, like Alton Ellis sing a song called Girl I've Got Today, doom, 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 doom. Doom, boom, boom, doom, 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 doom. And when Duke Reed put on that song, I was there. He had to play the song about 12 times. And you can see, this guy was very fast. He had to spin, he had to dance, he had to dance in a fast pace. So what we did was, at the time, most of them had the same bass line, because the bass man didn't have enough time to emphasize on his bass line. So what we did was cut it down a little, so the bass man could more move his fingers and have a line. So that's how he comes to have these reggae lines. You know, give him more time to do that. In this guy, he couldn't do that.
Reed's Trojan Sound System had been notorious for the vicious fights that often accompanied his dances. Experiences which made the ex-policeman the ideal man to set up his Treasure Isle studio amongst the rude boys of downtown Kingston.
He was a no-nonsense man. He never harbor any foolishness. Police used to go and come. If you're a rude boy, you have to leave your rude boy business outside, right? Then you could see him. As I say, he was a no-nonsense man.
And this is his studio over there on top. What is his studio? You know, his engineer was a man called Smitty, one of the best in Jamaica, Mr. Smitty, his engineer. Now, down here was his liquor store. You'd have a lot of boxes on the roads with liquor and drinks and all those, and nobody take anything. Well, you see, Duke, he's respected around the area, and he's well armed. He got at least 3 guns on him. one long one, one in his hip, and one on his feet. That's Duke, the first gunman in Western Kingston.
If Duke even not in the studio, him have a box downstairs in him liquor store. And when everybody upstairs dancing, so boy, this gone, this gone. And out of nowhere, blah, boom, boom, boom. And that Duke fire shot and the whole studio get quiet.
Do you see the big man? He run up the stairs. Say to Tom McCook and all those people, what are you playing? I don't want that. I want this, I want that. You know, everybody just shut up and listen to what he said.
Then you had a on man, he said, no, near Marquis. So listen, and you, so play it back, Smithy, and quiet, and Marquis put out him head like this and say, yes, yes, the boss was right. The tune need a 17 there, sir.
Rocksteady lasted 18 glorious months, but finally there was no escaping Jamaica's worsening conditions. Bass lines became heavier, and the subject matter more socially concerned.
And we're going to reggae now. And how we get to reggae now? Reggae is a different changing of the drum. We have the drum playing more burro-like. Oh, I don't know if you understand. Like tap ta da pa da pa pa da pa da pa pa da. And change the bass pattern.
If the music even slow, it make it sound like it fast. So that is what the reggae do to the rock steady. And that was it. Reggae, 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 reggae.
Reggae was everywhere. Dozens of studios sprang up and sheer volumes saturated the market. Producers needed a new outlet for the music.
A guy was working with Island at the time named Dave Bettridge come out here and meet me, and they invite me over to England in 68, and I see what the people are. England is the gateway to real reggae music.
The English market became essential to Jamaican producers with its large and by now settled Caribbean community.
When I went to London, Bob and Dan and myself, that was when I first learned that Feel Like Jumping was also a big song in England. We were just in Jamaica not knowing what was happening.
What was happening was that by the late 60s, companies like Trojan Records had spotted the large underground following that had developed for this new reggae pop music.
White kids that were hanging out with the black kids from the same areas, yeah, grew up on the music, you know, we were all hearing it.
It was just a fashion in the youth culture of the day.
Yeah,
know,
well, that was it. We only had the youth clubs. You know, I mean, nobody was old enough to go to nightclubs anyway.
That's it.
Trojan Records came to enjoy iconic status as the purveyors of Jamaican music in the UK. They released 2,000 singles in 7 years, initially on a fairly small scale, through specialized shops catering to Jamaicans and to white working class youths who reveled in its danceable beat and outlaw status, the skinheads.
You get kicked out of Saturday morning pictures when you're too old for it. You've got nowhere to go for yourself. So somebody said, oh, this got to Stretton Locarno. And we're talking about the 60s, sort of the skinhead period, really. And so I used to go to Stretton Locarno and listen to music, and we didn't really dance. People did dance, but me and my friends, we used to just sort of hang back and just watch, you know, because it was all the skinhead thing, you see, and because they never played that music on the radio, so in some ways for us it became our music.
The skinheads at the time were really into reggae. I mean, they are branded now as what you call a neo-Nazi group that don't like black people and Jews. In my time, I was being protected by the skinheads. Look, I've been to a town that was like Guildford, was a racist town in my time. And this guy said to me, "Hi, Mr. Black." So I said, "Hi, Mr. White." And he spit in my face. I said, "What the heck?" So the kids wanted us to beat him. But I said, "No, forget it, man. I just wiped the spit off," and that was it.
What was happening, it couldn't be denied that this was developing into something that was becoming more and more commercially interesting, commercially successful, as more and more people discovered the music through the clubs. And that was making for all sorts of problems for us, because we couldn't get past this door.
Long walk through the BBC, but I know I'll make it someday.
I think there was a perception amongst the reggae labels that the BBC dismissed reggae to a certain extent. To be fair, I think possibly, yes, I think they might have a slight case there.
Bob Marley and the Wailers failed their BBC audition because in the view of the panel, they didn't know how to play reggae. Which was, but then you get some kind of, you know, the BBC Dance Orchestra doing a strict tempo version of reggae. People would say, "Oh, that's how reggae should be."
If our music had an open door, like, let's say, a freeway, we could be wide in any part of the world, because we are class, we have class music like anybody else. Be young, gifted or black, open your heart to what I mean.
We just did that song because we were teenagers wearing afros and, you know, trying to be too conscious black people, and we said this is a good cover song for us to do.
Trojan were determined to break reggae to the mass market and pulled out all the stops for their new releases.
When they introduced strings on the British versions of the songs, I think it made quite a difference, because they made them more into, not so much the raw sound that would probably be acceptable elsewhere, but it made it more into a pop record, and then went to a much bigger market.
Reggae became part of pop mainstream. Skinheads, the BBC, school dances, suddenly everyone was playing reggae.
Sound the soul! I am the soul. And I'm still here again.
Dave and Ansel Collins went to number one, as did Desmond Dekker. Jimmy Cliff, the Scatterlights, Prince Buster, and Ken Booth all stormed the charts. And everyone loved it when Max Romeo turned out to be a new kind of rude boy.
Of course, there was the wonderful Max Romeo Wet Dream thing, which was just such a great pop record. Although, obviously, the lyrics, you know, you can see why they had a problem with that "lie down, girl, let me push it up, push it up."
I tried to explain. I said, "Look, man, I have nothing to do with sex. I'm talking about my house leaking here. Me and my lady sleeping in bed, rain falling. The roof is bloody leaking. She's getting up to plug the leak, and I'm saying, lie down, girl, I'll push it up." They didn't buy that.
The last couple of years of the 60s were a reggae explosion, and by 1969, Desmond Dekker was filling Wembley like visiting royalty.
That reggae pop music, I suppose, you know, we were beneficiaries of it as well, you know. The doors had been opened and people had been softened up enough to start listening, you know.
The music of downtown Kingston had not only conquered Jamaica, but made it to the heart of the old colonial masters. And there was still a great deal further to go. Oh, we gotta do our thing. Everybody got to rock. They gotta do your thing. You got to do your thing. Baby, you got to do your thing. And the story of Jamaican music continues tomorrow at 7. Later tonight, the influence of Caribbean migrants on Britain since the first major influx arrived in 1948. Windrush at 10. But next tonight, analysis of the big stories of the day from around the world. Stay with us.
Heads to the East Devon coast for the internationally renowned Sidmouth Folk Festival, which this year marks its golden jubilee, tonight at 9.
And this is BBC 4.
Iraqis return to their holy shrine in Najaf undamaged. But what does the deal that saved it do to Iraq's fragile government? Russian investigators find explosives on one of the crashed airliners. Now they suspect terrorism.
Russia's got to go! Stop! Drop! People
New York gets its first sight of the demonstrators accompanying the Republican convention. A quarter of a million more predicted. China marks the centenary of Deng Xiaoping's birth. Cause for celebration for the Communist Party he secured in power.
One for me, formidable.
French fights back against an avalanche of linguistic imports. But can its speakers save the language of Molière and Victor Hugo?
The French language, I don't want to sound chauvinistic, francocentric or parochial, but everyone knows that it's a masterpiece.
Hello, I'm Brian Hanrahan. This is The World. Muqtada al-Sadr, Iraq's rebellious clergyman, has handed over the keys of the holy shrine in Najaf and gone home. His men have downed arms and disappeared, slipping away with the crowds of pilgrims who flocked to the shrine on the call of the grand Ayatollah Ali al-Sistani. Ayatollah Sistani's mediation brought an end to the three-week siege in hours, a clear indication of his domination of Iraq's politics. But where does it leave everybody else? Most of all, what does it mean for Iraq's interim government and its chances of holding peaceful elections? Let's ask Matthew Price in Baghdad. Matthew, a real list of questions there. Let's do the bread and butter stuff first. What about the Mahdi army? Disarmed but not disbanded. They're still a force then.
Absolutely, Brian. I mean, this was, it seems, the point of the Grand Ayatollah's mediation efforts with Muqtada al-Sadr to give Muqtada al-Sadr a chance to be able to still hold his head high, to not feel that he had in any way capitulated to the interim government here or to the US forces that his men have been holed up against for 3 weeks in Najaf. We saw today that the Mehdi army simply melted away in amongst the supporters of the Grand Ayatollah Ali Sistani as those supporters left the shrine in Najaf. And then the police went in to the shrine itself. And there, as you'll see in this coming report, they made a pretty gruesome discovery.
It was just after first light when they reclaimed their shrine. Thousands pouring in to one of Shia Islam's most holy sites. For 3 weeks, al-Sadr's militia controlled the sanctuary. Now it's been returned to the people. Outside the shrine, Iraqi police moved in to take control of the streets, while US troops stood by. Muqtada al-Sadr's gunmen are meant now to withdraw. This morning, they were still making their presence felt. And these are still dangerous times in Najaf. One of Muqtada al-Sadr's spokesmen told reporters his forces had left the city.
The al-Mahdi army has left the holy city of Najaf and laid down their weapons. But the al-Mahdi army has not been disbanded as the authorities had wished. Every fighter has gone back to his province and the holy shrine has been handed back.
Nevertheless, the Iraqi interim government welcomed news of the end of the standoff.
No more fights. Najaf and Kufa will be peaceful cities. free from arms, free from the militia.
In Najaf today, they were clearing up the shrine, clearing it of the bodies of those killed during the last 3 weeks of fighting. Later, in a building in the compound, there was a more gruesome discovery. Dozens of bodies, among them police and civilians, according to officers here. Some burnt, some mutilated, slowly decaying in the fierce heat. On the streets, people are returning to see the damage.
The city has become stable, and we hope that peace and reconstruction can return to this province. We hope that residents can return to work after more than 3 weeks of stoppage.